how facial fat influences your looks and how much fat, how much body fat would you need to lose to look attractive? And is body fat and facial fat related? Let's look at this cool video by Quoves. I'm going to react to it. Let's see what we have going on.
In this episode, we're going to be taking a look at why facial fat and body fat percentages as a whole make such a noticeable difference in facial shape, perceptions, and attractiveness. It's not a stretch to say that facial fat can completely change how a person looks.
I get asked all the time in clinic, "Doc, if I lose facial fat, what's going to happen? Will I look younger? Will I need fillers or not?"
Firstly, what is body fat? Facial fat, body fat, any kind of fat? Well, the first thing we have to talk about, let's explain what facial fat actually is. Just like the fat found around your belly, adipose tissue gain is a natural process that results from an increase in energy intake. The body fat we want to focus on is subcutaneous fat, because that is a type of fat that's found under the skin. This applies not only to places like the stomach, but the face holds subcutaneous fat as well, especially around the buccal or the cheek region. When we eat less food and exercise more, we lose that extra adipose tissue.
So understand that fat is a store of energy. If you take too much food in, too much energy in, it's going to be stored somewhere. And there are different types of fat in the body. The face has fat deep and superficial. When we age, as we go forward in this video, understand there's shifting of fat pads. So there is age that plays a role, and the fat pads that used to sit up high descend down. So we need to keep that in mind. When you gain and lose weight, the fat pad that was higher that we liked may now be a little bit lower. Let's move on.
Same way that losing belly fat causes the abdominal muscles to start to pop out and you get abs, the exact same thing applies to the face. The difference is, it's mostly the bones, like the jawline and the cheekbones, that we quickly see popping instead of, say, a muscle like the rectus abdominis. The general idea of depth and 3D-ness is what makes an attractive face. The abs seem to have a lot more depth as you lose body fat, and so do the cheekbones, the mid-face region, the jawline. Even though we usually see photos from a 2D view, we can still pick up that depth perception. A face with more facial fat just lacks these contours in that 3D context. Coleman et al. Discussed the importance of considering the 3D-ness of the midface region when assessing attractiveness.
So when you see many of my videos and when I'm assessing facial fat, volume loss or volume gain with our treatments, remember fillers or PR, if you gain volume in the face, that's why I use 3D imaging. And with my patients, we can see 3D imaging. Very important and great point he makes.
Even moderate amounts of fat gain can completely change your face shape and attractiveness. Taylor Lautner loses a lot of the angularity around his midface to lower face. These are some of the more obvious effects of weight gain. An overall poofier face with rounded cheeks and jaw. You don't need me to tell you that. Most of you are probably already aware of how this works.
Now you see with this one, on this picture, do you see how the facial shape is a triangle? We want an inverted triangle. We want that shape. But his main width is just above the gonial angles. So it's a little higher. And that's not the most attractive look. And you get temporal hollowing. Hollowing of the temples with age.
The zygion is the widest part of your face where your cheekbones are. When you gain body fat, you lose whatever the contours you had in this region that already existed. Usually there will be a slight dip right above and below the cheekbones at the temporal region. A lean face will have more contours and be more shapelier and angular.
This makes that point. Look at the picture on the left. The widest point is down here. Some people tend to want to call that, as we age, the peanut head. I'm not a big fan of that. I think it's kind of a negative in connotation. It's more so referred to females because they lose more bone, get more temporal hollowing, and women actually come in and say, "Doc, fix my peanut head."
This is most easily seen in the mandible as you lose weight, but the same concept can apply to all areas of the face. Since we tend to gain facial fat around the midface region and the jaw, extreme cases of fat gain can completely change your face shape, causing all sorts of facial contours and proportions that don't really look natural. Chris Pratt had an incredible weight loss journey, and his facial attractiveness improved a lot as a result. We can see that his face just lacked the angularity, and now it's a lot more striking.
That's fairly dramatic, and you can see the jawline is well defined, associated with masculinity, and the rounder face is a little more feminine. You will also note there's more lines and folds, and that's what people tend to say, well, I looked younger with facial fat. So there's fat and there's contour. And a lot of people, I had a guy come in the other day and he says, I looked younger when I was 25 than now at 40. I said, show me a picture. He had a round face at 25. He was more angular now. And when we had that conversation about the high cheekbone versus the round face, it made some sense for him to keep some contours but add subtle volume. So it's all about strategic placement. So this gets complicated, but you can see this is a great demonstration, especially the jawline. The other thing as we move forward here, understand young people I'll consider him young, as they lose facial fat, they gain contour because the skin contracts. There's collagen, elastin, and hormones that help it do that. As we age, that fat is displaced.
Like we mentioned earlier, there is the 3D aspect of the face that is also night and day in terms of differences. His buccal region was a lot more plump beforehand. The loss of facial fat helped accentuate the deep contours and valleys around his cheeks.
Now, do you see the anterior cheek? If I fill an anterior cheek like he outlined prior, and on this picture, even in a thin person, they'll say, Doc, you made me look fat. So that anterior cheek is way different than the high lateral model, high cheekbone that says youth, beauty, and fertility. The front of the cheek says weight gain. So some thin people like it because if they're being told, are you eating? Are you anorexic? They want that volume in the front so that people don't harass them for being too low of a weight.
The under eye region, the chin, and the glabella or the brow area. The jaws also has a lot more depth and shadows to it. Chris's facial width to height ratio went down a considerable amount as his cheeks slimmed down. This can affect the perceptions of masculinity, creativity, aggressiveness.
Do you see how it changed the length of the face? Because the face and look is boxy, and that's the point here. When there's more anterior volume, the face looks a little more convex. And when you lose that anterior fat, it looks a little more concave. That gives the impression of length. This is why the facial consult, if you're getting fillers, if you're getting surgery, is key.
And a number of other factors like dominance, but it's not that big of a difference in this case.
Do you notice here the brow? A male brow during development, during hormonal changes in utero, the male brow sits forward, aggressive. And you can see with the loss of volume, the brow in the right picture looks more male, more masculine, almost like frontal bossing.
It just looks taller and less bloated, which is a benefit no matter how you look at it. Playing around in the liquify tool, we can sort of manipulate the weight and loss gain just by altering the facial width and facial contours, but it's not perfect and it's quite difficult to show this in Photoshop. It's one of the most challenging things. How does gaining facial fat change facial proportions? A face from this study by Rule et al. Was altered to show a reduction in BMI. Personally, the edit doesn't seem to do a very good job of showing the weight difference, but one major proportion did change. The eye spacing changes a decent amount, in that the interpupillary distance, or the distance between the eyes, makes up more of the facial width after weight loss.
Key. So, do you understand here what he's talking about? The interpupillary distance is fixed because of the bone, the cranium. And that's why often when people measure with golden ratios, they look at that distance as a constant. This applies to fillers. If you think about when we create cheeks and we go laterally, you can only go so far because of a couple things, mainly three things. Number one, as we go wider in the lateral cheek, the eyes are going to look more set in, more close, and that can be odd. The other two hollows we worry about are the temporal hollowing and the buccal fat region, if you will, the submalar area or the area below the zygomatic bone, because As we come out here, we're then forced to fill the temp a little bit and the submalar in many people. Otherwise, it will look too hollow. And hollowness says sickly. You remember HIV lipoatrophy, the drugs that cause hollowing of the face and the stigma around that. We often use biostimulators like Sculptra to reverse that sickly hollowing of the face and the stigma with that. So that's what he's talking about here with the weight change.
In essence, losing facial fat makes the eyes appear wider set and larger. Derek from More Place, More Dance also achieved a similar effect. His face seems slimmer, eyes larger, and...
And larger eyes are associated with femininity. And so when you get a larger face with more fat, it looks estrogenic, like female hormones, and fat in the belly actually produces estrogen and creates that female beer belly, like I've been drinking a bunch of stout IPAs. But you can see that's more of a male, slanted downward eye, narrower frontal bossing.
And even his jaw is proportionally wider. An overlooked aspect of facial attractiveness is retaining a wide jaw and compact mid-face appearance, despite the actual face being slimmer. That comes down to a bone structure difference, where most people can achieve a wide jaw and mid-face if they just gain a lot of fat. This guy is an even more exaggerated example of this. This is because when we gain fat around our cheeks, our bizygomatic width, or the width of our face, actually starts to increase. Your face gets bigger, physically bigger. This can sometimes work to your favor if you have really close set eyes that throw off the facial harmony. Losing weight may help offset that by making your eyes appear closer to the edge of the face. Thus, you get the appearance of having wider set eyes. Conversely, gaining weight may help offset overly wide set eyes, because now your eyes look like they're more inwards towards the face.
And we can create this with fillers and biostimulators very nicely and very pointedly. And that's why creating the shapes, we're talking fat here, but creating the shapes with exogenous product is absolutely possible. It's judicious use and not overdoing.
This guy made some drastic improvements in all parts of his face. His jaw got way more tapered and now has a discernible jaw frontal angle, whereas his jaw was round beforehand. His cheekbones now appear more high and pronounced. The excess adipose tissue around the cheeks make the under eye region look hollower and more set back than it actually is.
And when the eyes go set back, it gives the appearance of frontal bossing, which is male, which is power, which is success. Just like what the jawline in psychology studies has been proven to be.
But after weight loss, everything seems to even out more, while at the same time adding the element of depth. The buccal region and the infraorbital region, or simply put, the midface, just appear way less pudgy or pinchable, which are real terms. Since fat really likes to go in these areas, they are also one of the last areas to lose fat. Will Smith's cheeks looked a lot more defined even after 20 pounds of fat loss. Similar to the guy before, Derek achieved a more tapered and defined jaw by getting below 10% body fat. His jaw went from a rounded shape to a harmonious angle of inclination.
Below 10% body fat, quite hard to do, and females, of course, carry naturally much more body fat than 10%.
All from about 70 to 80 pounds of body fat loss. These types of transformation extremes are hard to come by, as most people won't ever venture that low of a body fat.
What are we seeing it now with? Ozempic, the weight loss drug that everyone's on. I was shocked. I was at a recent Congress, hadn't seen some people in years. They're a shadow of their former self. Ozempic, and I have a whole video on that. But you're seeing people lose 30, 40, 50, 60 pounds, and their whole face is changing. In the aesthetic world, these people have access to all the fillers and biostimulators they need, but for most people, they're getting Ozempic face.
The last question is, how does gaining fat affect the side profile? Just like the front view, losing facial fat can make a huge improvement to your side profile. In major transformations, a person could essentially find their jawline, as if they thought they didn't have a jawline, and then they lose the fat and realize, oh, I have a really nice jawline, really nice.
Young person again, so it's going to tighten the skin, and it's not just fat, but genetic cervical mental angle will play a role. But some people genetically just have a wattle or submental fat as well. But this is a beautiful demonstration of someone who can lose weight and gain their jawline back, because the jawline was lost because of the weight gain. not because of genetics.
Really nice bone structure. This guy goes from no discernible goneal angle or jaw angle to a clearly visible mandible, ramus, and jaw outline. Beyond that, his submental or the cervical angle, which is the angle his neck makes with the jaw, completely starts to change. This is actually quite an important feature when it comes to perceived attractiveness because it is strongly correlated with body fat levels and forward levels of facial growth. Research by Naini et al. Shows strong correlation between this angle and the facial aesthetic or the attractiveness of a subject.
Absolutely key, and we create it all the time. Kybella, which is a fat dissolving injection, they really looked at that cervical, mental angle, and showed some nice improvements.
An angle around 95 degrees is most pleasing, which basically produces a firm and taut look where you don't have any hanging skin or excess fat in the underjaw region. Liposuction or fat loss can lower this measurement by a good amount, even by up to 20 degrees, but an increase of this angle results in lowered perceived attractiveness. Usually hanging neck or skin and fat is associated with both aging and body fat gain, so it kind of makes sense. If you've ever heard of jowls, it's something you get as you get older, that raises this angle, which is why we perceive it with negative attractiveness traits.
We hear about jowls all the time. You guys always ask me about jowls.
A study by Coleman et al. Talks about the aging face, and we'll probably have to make a whole other video on that. But decreased jaw definition, facial jowls, and a turkey neck are all common signs of aging. The study even touches on the mentor cervical angle worsening as the hyoid bone descends and the region below the jaw just seems to droop. The hyoid bone is basically where the neck ends and the head starts. It's this low-hanging bone. And if you have a low hyoid bone, it pushes your underjaw region lower and you seem to have a turkey neck even if you don't have one and you're very lean. Since a defined jaw and firm neck are youthful features, fat gain can essentially make you look older, even if the region below your jaw becomes too undefined. On top of all of this, a leaner face just looks more youthful in general. Being at a healthy body fat percentage will optimize your hormonal profile and general
healthy body fat.
General health, your skin, hair, eyebrow density, and other indicators will improve in suit. The million-dollar question then is, how much weight do you actually need to lose?
This is indeed the million-dollar question. How much weight do you need to lose to look more youthful, to look younger?
Come that attractive face. Well, the answer isn't simple, obviously, but in a paper by Nicholas Rule and Daniel E., there were some interesting nuances found with how weight affects facial attractiveness. The simplest thing to note was that the adiposity, or the body fat levels basically, is strongly correlated with facial attractiveness. Underweight and overweight faces were judged as less attractive than those with healthy BMI.
Key. Underweight not good, overweight not good.
The slightly discouraging takeaway from this study was that while people can notice even slight weight changes in your face, it takes a lot more weight gain to change your facial attractiveness. This does kind of make sense when you think about it. A facial fat may be one of the last places to go.
And that is one of the positive things about fillers and biostimulators, is that if you're at a healthy weight, then we can manipulate small things with those products to create great angles. The other thing to note here, talk about displacement of fat pads. What keeps them up? Prevention. And the other thing is exercise. In my patients, when they lose weight, if they lose it gradually and they exercise at the same time, sleep and nutrition are key too, but exercise, in my opinion, really maintains the fat and the face fat. When people lose it with drugs like Ozempic, that's a hit to the system. They look old, they get that Ozempic face. But if you exercise at the same time, there's something very special about that, and you get skin tightening, rejuvenation, and the fat pads maintain much better.
This does make sense intuitively, as facial fat is one of the last regions to go, so you need to lose a lot of weight before it starts coming off your face. Most of your body fat is held below the shoulders, and you're going to have to basically reduce a significant amount of body fat to show off any facial gains, in simple terms. Most models are at the low end of the normal BMI range, or even sometimes underweight, and this certainly brings out the bone structure for the runway look.
So key, again, and that's why models are often criticized, or those who are choosing the models, they choose them thinner than they need to be because they want the cheekbone. And they're selling something. So models are selling something. And the cheekbone and the hollow buckle area, particularly the cheekbone, high cheekbone, youth, beauty, and fertility, that's the attraction of the opposite, in some cases the same sex, is that high cheekbone and that sculpted jawline and face. And that is a problem in the industry.
It's not always efficient in maximizing facial attractiveness. To appear lighter, a subject only had to lose about 1.3 BMI points, but to appear more facially attractive, it was about 2.5. So a much bigger change to actually, for it to come off your face.
And that's an important point and a difficult one to meet. So you have to lose a lot to become attractive. I would say you lose it with exercise, now you're in business.
But the paper did not extend outside of the scope of Northern America, so we're looking at this from a very Western-centric approach, and it is well researched that cultural influence can affect the weight to facial attractiveness relationship.
Yeah, so if I'm in the Philippines, certain parts of Asia, a lot of people, especially men, carry more fat on the face genetically. Sometimes it drives them crazy. And that's why one of the reasons in South Korea, men have such a high rate of facelifts under the age of 50.
For instance, in some cultures, being rounder and puffier is actually desired. Like in, I think it was Mauritania. Lay et al. Found that fat mass really only seems to affect facial masculinity in underweight men. Basically, facial fat can add some masculinity if a man looks overly gaunt or emaciated. We do seem to prefer defined masculine faces in the West. An overly gaunt face can signal illness, lack of food, fragility, all of which aren't exactly attractive or desirable traits for a man. Sometimes losing weight is not the best way to improve your looks. Being at a normal weight is almost always going to be more attractive than either end of the extreme.
Very true, and much more healthy.
While losing some extra weight within that normal range may add that boost in attractiveness, there are trade-offs to consider. A person should really consider their mental state and reasons for losing weight. It's well researched that improving one's attractiveness is a much larger motivator when it comes to weight loss than for actual health improvements.
So true, especially now with social media.
There is nothing wrong with that really, but if you are tunneled in on the attractiveness part, you can compromise on your mental and physical health. Especially a good example of this is taking steroids to get leaner. You're sacrificing health for attractiveness, and they're not exactly correlated in this modern context. This model may look good in both photos, but she has noted her struggles with her body image and weight journey, and her face is arguably more attractive in the left photo as it is slimmer, more feminized, and more angular. However, the difference is not make or break and certainly not worth developing an eating disorder over.
What's that say on the left? Osteoporosis. That's what you see long term. A white female, probably nutritionally deficient. There's many problems, but one of them is longer term bone loss. It's just not healthy.
This is an issue within the modeling industry where models and even ourselves as normal people have been conditioned to associate these extremes with beauty. While yes, being lean maximizes facial attractiveness, research would not seem to support the extremes of Western modeling standards. That in itself is a beauty standard that's in an isolated bubble. Lastly, weight loss will not look the same for everyone. Your underlying bone structure will determine how contoured and angular your face looks at the end, and every step of that way in between. Some faces look a lot leaner than others, despite being higher body fat.
And you can see this gal on the left with the fuller face. People are going to tell her, you look great. You don't have a wrinkle on your face. On the right, of course, it's airbrushed and there's makeup on there. But I can tell you, she will have more wrinkles, especially if she's over the age of 30. And of course, there'll be hormonal changes with that weight loss. So there's when you talk about beauty, it's also fine lines and wrinkles, but also facial shape. They go together.
Losing body fat is probably one of the most worthwhile ways to improve your looks, especially for those that are overweight. The 9-12% range for men and 17-20% for women generally maximizes facial attractiveness. While a bit above that will also do a comparable job, getting above 16-17% or so for men and 25% for women may start to detract from facial attractiveness. But again, everyone is different and they do store body fat differently.
I agree with those percentages. And again, exercise key. So very interesting, facial fat. I have videos on how to maintain your facial fat. What kills it? Of course, sun, poor nutrition, poor diet, over-exercising certain drugs, and what maintains it is health, nutrition, great skincare, and hormones. Another key one to maintain it, healthy hormones, and hormones go with great relationships, good body weight, and of course, for females, as the hormones dip, it's a consideration of whether you want to go on hormone replacement therapy. And as he mentioned here, I'm not an advocate of testosterone or steroid therapy for men because that comes with its own health problems, but very fascinating in the facial fat. What are you finding? I put a complete video up here on how to maintain your facial fat. Stay tuned here. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.